हेलो चिल्ड्रन, वेलकम टू 10th स्टैंडर्ड सोशल स्टडीज़ क्लास। होप यू आर ऑल फाइन एंड सेफ एट होम। दिस इज़ द सेकेंड कंटिन्यूएशन पार्ट ऑफ चैप्टर 5, दैट इज़ इंडियन रिवर्स एंड वाटर रिसोर्सेस। चिल्ड्रन, इन द लास्ट क्लास वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट इंडस रिवर सिस्टम एंड गंगा रिवर सिस्टम। Let us, in this class, discussion start with Brahmaputra river system. River Brahmaputra is another important river of India, which originate from Himalayas. Children, you can observe in this map the Brahmaputra river. The Brahmaputra river originates from Kailash Range, located near Mansarovar Lake of the Greater Himalayas. So you can observe here on the top or north part of the map, the river Brahmaputra starts and flows towards east. And if you can observe carefully, it enters into India in the state of Arunachal Pradesh. So river Brahmaputra flows towards east, then enters into Arunachal Pradesh, and it also flows to Bangladesh, then it falls into Bay of Bengal. So children, in this map you can well observe the course or flow of Brahmaputra river. You can see that it is entering into Arunachal Pradesh, then even flows to Assam, then goes to Bangladesh, then falls into Bay of Bengal. So children, here are some important points about Brahmaputra river. River Brahmaputra rises in Tibet east of Mansarovar Lake. It flows eastward parallel to Himalayas. On reaching the Namcha Barwa, this is a mountain peak, 7,757 meter. Near this mountain peak, Brahmaputra river takes a U-turn and then it enters into India in Arunachal Pradesh through a gorge. So children, next two names, Dibang and Lohit. These are the two important tributaries or small rivers which join to Brahmaputra river. River Brahmaputra forms riverine island. And another important fact is that Brahmaputra river is known as Tsangpo in Tibet and Jamuna in Bangladesh. Children, another interesting fact about Brahmaputra river is that perhaps this is the only river in the Indian part which has a male name. The remaining rivers like Ganga, Yamuna, Godavari or Kaveri or even Krishna, actually the full name of river Krishna is Krishnaveni, and even Indus, whose actual name is Sindhu, all the other rivers have female names. But maybe the only river which has the male name among the Indian rivers is Brahmaputra river. So this is one interesting thing about the Brahmaputra river, children. Next, we move forward to know some more details about Brahmaputra system. The Brahmaputra, known as Tsangpo in Tibet, rises from the snout of Shema Yangdang Glacier of the Kailash Range near Mansarovar. As you know children, many of the Himalayan rivers originate in the glaciers. Glaciers are the large accumulations of snow. So like that, Brahmaputra also originate from the glacier, which is called Shema Yangdang. And when it flows through Tibet, it is the Brahmaputra river is called Tsangpo in Tibet. Then it flows eastwards through southern Tibet. Near Lhotse Jong, it opens into a wide navigable channel for about 640 kilometers. Then it enters in a great loop southwest through Arunachal Pradesh in India, first as the Siang and then as the Han. That means it moves around a mountain hill and takes the shape of a loop at southwest, and then it enters into Arunachal Pradesh. And when it enters into Arunachal Pradesh, first it is called Siang, and after some distance it is called as the Hang. So children, you can observe in this picture river Brahmaputra taking U-turn around the hill or mountain Namcha Barua. After that, this river emerges into Assam Valley, and then it is joined by two tributaries, Dibang and the Lohit. From here, the river is known as Brahmaputra. Remember one thing, children, when Brahmaputra enters into Assam, it is called Sedong. After that, two tributaries joined to it, Dibang and the Lohit, and then it is known as Brahmaputra. Already you have seen that first it enters into Arunachal Pradesh, so in that time it is known as Siang, and after some time, after some distance, it is called the Hang, and then it enters into Assam. So in Assam it is first called Sedong. Then when the two tributaries Dibang and Lohit joins with this, then the combined stream, then it is known as Brahmaputra. Children, you can observe here river Brahmaputra entering into Bangladesh, and you can also observe river Ganga also enters into Bangladesh. Children, remember that river Brahmaputra, when enters into Bangladesh, it is called Jamuna, and river Ganga, when enters into Bangladesh, it is called Padma. So now the two rivers, that is Jamuna and Padma, you can observe in the map that they join with each other in Bangladesh. And when the two rivers join, the joined stream in Bangladesh is called Meghna river. So children, Meghna river is made by combination of river Ganga and river Brahmaputra in Bangladesh. And then the river Meghna, which is the combination of river Ganga and river Brahmaputra, falls into Bay of Bengal. Okay children, now let us discuss about peninsular rivers. Children, these peninsular rivers originate either in western ghats or the plateau or hill areas of the central part of India. These peninsular rivers are non-perennial in nature. That means they have more water during rainy season, but they have less water in summer season. So they do not have full flow of water throughout the year, like Himalayan rivers. Himalayan rivers are perennial rivers. They have full flow of water throughout the year. But peninsular rivers are non-perennial. It is because these rivers are rain-fed rivers. Their flow of water depend upon the rain. So in the rainy season, peninsular rivers are full of water. Most of these peninsular rivers are either east flowing, but few of them are west flowing rivers. Children, many of these peninsular rivers originate in the Western Ghats. The Western Ghats are the water divide between the major peninsular rivers, discharging their water in the Bay of Bengal and its small rivulets joining the Arabian Sea. So you can observe here, Western Ghats are marked in the Indian map. So children, here you can observe two rivers, Narmada and Tapti. They flowing towards west. So you can observe here children, two rivers, Narmada and Tapti, are flowing towards west. And they are flowing in the areas of Madhya Pradesh to Maharashtra, and then they flow to Arabian Sea. So these two, Narmada and Tapti rivers, are two rivers which are west flowing. And you can observe the remaining rivers, like here Mahanadi, which is flowing in the Chhattisgarh to Odisha. It is flowing toward east and falls into Bay of Bengal. In the same way, Godavari river, which originates in the Western Ghats of Maharashtra, flowing towards east, reaches to Andhra Pradesh and then falls into Bay of Bengal. In the same way, River Krishna originates in the Western Ghats of Maharashtra, flowing towards east, reaches to Andhra Pradesh and ultimately falls into Bay of Bengal. In the same way, another peninsular river, Kaveri, starts in Karnataka, reaches to Tamil Nadu and falls into Bay of Bengal. So in this way, you can observe that most of the South Indian peninsular rivers are east flowing, but except Narmada and Tapti, which flow to west and fall into Arabian Sea. So children, you can observe here, Narmada, Tapti, Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri, etc. are some of the peninsular rivers. Most of the peninsular rivers like Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna, etc. flow from west to east and join to Bay of Bengal. But two peninsular rivers, Narmada and Tapti, flow from east to west and join Arabian Sea. Now children, look at some of the important mountain ranges in the peninsular India. Here in the map, they are located as dark lines. Here you can see Aravali is marked here near the Thar Desert. Then you can observe here Vindhyas and Satpuras. Children, you can observe here around the areas of Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra. You can see Vindhyas and Satpuras. Vindhyas means Vindhyachal Mountain and Satpura Range. So you can observe here. So nearby these ranges, Narmada River and Tapti River will flow. And you can observe the along the eastern coast, there are Eastern Ghats, and along the Western Ghats are located along the western coast of India. Children, let us discuss about Narmada River. In the map, you have already observed that Narmada River flows towards west and falls into Arabian Sea. And another important thing about Narmada River is that Sardar Sarovar Dam project is made on this river, which is completed in 2017. Here are some important points about Narmada River. The Narmada Basin is in the Amarkantak Hills of Madhya Pradesh. It means River Narmada originates in the Amarkantak Hills of Madhya Pradesh. Then it flows towards west and it flows through a rift valley. Rift Valley is a place between the two mountains. So here, children, you can remember that Rift Valley is formed because of the existence of Vindhyachal Mountains and Satpura Mountains. And through this valley, Narmada River flows towards west and falls into Arabian Sea. Children, let us now discuss about Tapti River. This river is also called Tapi River. River Tapti also originates in Madhya Pradesh, then it flows towards Gujarat and falls into Arabian Sea. So Tapti River is another river which flows towards west and falls into Arabian Sea. So children, remember that River Tapti has source in the Satpura Range and its mouth before falling to Arabian Sea is Gulf of Khambat. Do you know, children, what is the mouth of the river? The mouth of the river is a place where the flow of the river going to end and it is going to join the sea or ocean. So remember, children, actually river mouth means it is the ending part of the river. The starting part of the river is called origin of the river and ending part is called mouth of the river. River Tapti originates at a place called Multai in Betul district of Madhya Pradesh. It rises from Satpura mountain ranges. Tapti flows parallel to Narmada River but to the south of Satpura ranges. Children, look here once again. The flowing route of Narmada and Tapti flowing towards west and falling into Arabian Sea. Now let us have a look at the other rivers, children. Other peninsular rivers which flow towards east and fall into Bay of Bengal. The major river systems of the peninsular plateau which originate in the Western Ghats are Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna and Kaveri. So children, these important rivers, that is Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna and Kaveri, originate in the Western Ghats and then they flow towards east and fall into Bay of Bengal. South Indian peninsular rivers are characterized by non-perennial flow of water. That means, as I told you earlier, they are not full of water throughout the year. They are rain-fed. In the rainy season, they are full of water, but the water in these rivers decreases in the summer seasons. Now children, among the east flowing peninsular rivers, Godavari River is the biggest river. River Godavari originates at Trayambakeshwar in Nasik district of Maharashtra. This river is also called Dakshina Ganga. Pravara, Purna, Vardha, Penaganga, Manjira, etc. are its tributaries. So remember, children, River Godavari starts at Trayambakeshwar in Nasik district of Maharashtra. And remember that the hills are, or the mountains are, Western Ghats from where River Godavari starts. So children, here in the map you can observe how the Godavari River is located in the map. You can observe that from Maharashtra, the line indicating Godavari River is drawn towards east, and then you can observe the W shape part of Andhra Pradesh. The W shape's upper part is joined with the line indicating the Godavari. The Godavari is the largest peninsular river system. The source of this river is in the Trayambak Plateau near Nasik in Maharashtra and discharges its water into Bay of Bengal. And children, you must remember that river Godavari enters into Basar in Telangana. Then in Andhra Pradesh, it first enters into West Godavari district and then it enters to East Godavari district, where in the village Antarvedi, it joins to Bay of Bengal. Just below the city of Rajahmundry in Andhra Pradesh, an aqueduct was constructed on it, like a small dam, near Dhavaleshwaram by Sir Arthur Thomas Cotton. Later, Indian government constructed into a big dam and called Arthur Cotton Barrage or Dhavaleshwaram Project, which is completed in 1970. Children, now let us discuss about another river which flows in Andhra Pradesh, flows to east and falling into Bay of Bengal. River Krishna. River Krishna also starts from Maharashtra and flows towards east, reaches to Andhra Pradesh, then falls into Bay of Bengal. So children, you can observe River Krishna located in this map. You can observe that the line indicating River Krishna is drawn from the Western Ghats part of Maharashtra towards east or right side, and you can see that it is joined to the lower part of the W shape of Andhra Pradesh area, and then River Krishna falls into Bay of Bengal. Here are some important points about Krishna River, children. River Krishna is also called Krishnaveni River. It rises in Mahabaleshwar of Maharashtra, flows into Bay of Bengal, Tungabhadra, Koyana, Musi, etc., their tributaries. And its drainage basin is shared by Maharashtra, Karnataka, and Andhra Pradesh. At Hamsala Devi near Koduru, River Krishna joins to Bay of Bengal. A dam constructed on this river at Vijayawada is Prakasham Barrage, which was completed in 1959. Now children, let us discuss about another important river, that is Mahanadi River. So River Mahanadi flows in the parts of Chhattisgarh and Odisha. So you can observe here River Mahanadi. It is originating in the state Chhattisgarh, flowing towards east, towards Odisha, then falls into Bay of Bengal. River Mahanadi originates from Shishwa Mountains in Chhattisgarh, and then it enters Odisha, then it falls into Bay of Bengal. Remember children, the dam Hirakud Dam is constructed on River Mahanadi near Sambalpur in Odisha. Children, River Kaveri is another important river in South India. It originates in Karnataka and flows to Tamil Nadu, where it joins to Bay of Bengal. So children, you can observe the location of River Kaveri in the map. Here are some important points about River Kaveri. The origin of this river is traditionally placed at Talakaveri, Kodagu in Western Ghats in Karnataka. And the last point you can observe, children, the River Kaveri makes the second biggest waterfall in India, that is known as Jog Falls. So the second biggest waterfall known as Jog Falls are located on River Kaveri. Now children, here is a small test for you. The river Godavari originates in dash and dash. So here is the answer. The river Godavari originates in Trayambak Plateau near Nasik in Maharashtra and falls into Bay of Bengal. Next is, the Krishna is the second largest east flowing peninsular river, which rises near dash. The answer is Mahabaleshwar, Maharashtra. Next, the Mahanadi rises near Sihawa in Chhattisgarh and runs through. So children, Mahanadi originates in Chhattisgarh, then it reaches to Odisha and fall into Bay of Bengal. Okay, the next one is, the Narmada originates near dash in Madhya Pradesh. The Narmada originates in Amarkantak. Next, the Tapati originates from dash and floats dash. The Tapati originates in Mahadev Hills, Madhya Pradesh, and flows to west. Now children, let us have a look on different aspects of water use. Water is a resource that becomes available to us as an annual flow. That is, we try to estimate how much we would be able to use during the year. In order to do this, we need to recall the water cycle and estimate the inflows and outflows during the year. Inflows and outflows can be estimated at different levels. So children, we are all using the water in different ways. When a nation want to manage the water in such a way to distribute to all the purposes in a correct way, it is necessary that the flow of water should be estimated, and generally it is estimated as an annual flow. So we try to estimate how much water will be available during the year. So after this estimation, it can be planned how to use the water for different purposes. So in order to do that, we should have knowledge about water cycle as well as water budget. So like children, for income, we make a budget. And here we estimate that what are our incomes and what are our expenditures and what is our savings. These are called budget. Like water budget is the estimation of inflow and outflow, and the water which we can save for the use. So all these estimations are included in the water budget. Children, idea of a water budget would apply to a small or large regions such as village or a district also. Now children, Let us understand what is the inflow of water. For any area, inflow is equal to surface flow plus groundwater flow plus precipitation. So children, surface flow includes rivers, streams, canals and other flows on the surface through which water is coming towards our area where we are estimating. Next, groundwater flow is the water flowing towards that area underground. Precipitation includes rain, snow, dew, hail, etc. So children, these three sources will bring the water towards an area. So it is called inflow. So for any area, inflow of water is estimated by adding surface flow plus groundwater flow plus precipitation. Now, let us see what is the meaning of outflow. For any area, outflow is equal to evapotranspiration plus groundwater and surface water outflow plus water for agriculture plus water for domestic purpose and for animals plus water for industrial use. So children, here are different ways of outflow of water in an area. First one is evapotranspiration. So this words combines two words, evaporation and transpiration. Evaporation is all that area's water which turns into water vapor because of the heat of the sun. So water of the different sources like lakes or rivers in that area turning into vapor because of the sun's heat, that is evaporation. And transpiration is the flow of water vapor from the plants and trees. So combining this called evapotranspiration. So you can see that by evapotranspiration, some of the water will outflow or go from our area. Another outflow is groundwater and surface water outflow. So some of the water, either it may be groundwater or surface water, will be outflowing from our estimating area. So this is also included in the outflow. Next, you know children, some water is used for agriculture. So when we use the water for agriculture, some of it sinks into underground, some of it evaporated, some of it taken by the crops. So here is also some water is used. So it will be estimated as outflow. Next, water for domestic purpose and for animals. So when the water is used for domestic purpose and for animals, it will also ultimately drain out. So it is also counted as outflow. Water for industrial use. So this water which is used for industrial use is ultimately drained out, so it is also estimated as a outflow. Now children, you may wonder why we need the estimation of inflow and outflow of water. So here is the answer. With the help of rate of inflow and outflow of water, we can estimate the stock of water in an area depending on comparative rates of input and outflow. We can judge what is happening to the stock of water over many years. So children, inflow of water and outflow of water gives us the water budget. By this we can estimate what is the stock of water in our area. Depending on the rates of input and output or inflow and outflow, we can judge what is happening to the stock of water in our area. Is the stock decreasing? Is the stock increasing? And children, remember that the question that we face today is the depletion of groundwater storages and the tendency not to care about the availability for future generations. So children, by the inflow and outflow of water, we can know about the stock of the water. And why that knowledge is necessary? Because we need to have some stock of water either on the surface or underground to use for the long time, maybe year or more. Because important question we are facing today, first is depletion of groundwater. The groundwater is decreasing. And a more important problem is that many people have the tendency not to care about the availability of water for the future generations. So here, when the present generation is using the water carelessly, the future generation have to face problem of decreased water storages. So it is necessary that present generation should take necessary precautions so that the future generations will not face problem of lack of water, or for that matter lack of any natural resources. Okay children, in the next class we will be discussing about how in different areas people tried to conserve the water by different methods and what were the outcomes of such efforts. Thank you.